This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Okay. Welcome to a very wet morning in the Sabi Sands, and you are on Safari Live. Good morning everybody, and welcome to our sunrise drive or sunrise safari this morning. We are in the Sabi Sands. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this morning I have VM. Morning VM. And Taylor and Dave are out on the other vehicle. The ladies in the FC, Rebecca, and I think Lou is with her this morning. Great to have all of you with us again. And welcome to a very, very wet Sabi Sands this morning, or Juma Game Reserve, which we are situated in. And we had a lot of rain last night. We had a massive, massive storm, which was fantastic. And it does seem to be very quiet at the moment. The roads have all been washed clean, so this is great for us. It makes it a lot easier to hopefully find some tracks. It has hardened the ground a little bit. But if we do find any tracks, we then at least know that they are very, very fresh. So let's see what we can find this morning. I'm in search for leopard. So just driving around and hopefully going to pick up on any signs of leopard tracks or dung. Or if we're very lucky, perhaps a leopard made a kill during the evening. Predators love to hunt in this rain. So we'll see what we can find. It's a much cooler morning, about 22 degrees Celsius, or about 72 degrees Fahrenheit. And it's a beautiful morning. It's so fresh after that rain. All the dust has settled, wonderful smells in the air, and it really is fantastic. We even had hail last night, some serious hail. So a few of us had to rush out and put the covers on the vehicles. It was a lot of fun, but stormed for most of the evening, which is great. We need this rain. We still need a lot more rain, but this is a good start. We had quite a decent amount. I'm not exactly too sure how much, but we will try to find out. Just having a look while we're driving along. Any signs of animals walking along the boundary road? Occasionally what happens after the rain, a lot of these scent markings that animals have done is washed away, and then you get the predators covering their territories again and remarking the boundaries of their territory. So maybe we're lucky and we have some of that this morning. We had a great day yesterday. There was a lot of lion activity. The lions hunted and killed two or three buffalo, which was amazing. They were very successful yesterday with hunting. And so we'll see. We did hear them last night. Perhaps they are around. While we continue our search for any predator activity this morning, Taylor would like to say good morning to you.
And a good morning it is to all of you who are watching today. Welcome, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me, we've got David. There's David. It was very interesting last night with all the wonderful thunder and lightning and of course hail. So it was actually quite entertaining when we all had to get up to quickly race around, running around, checking that no windows are left open and all the different vehicles, and those hailstones were quite big. I'm glad nobody got donked on the head last night. If you're wondering what my plan is this morning, is to actually try and follow up on, of course, the Nkuhumas again. So we're on Mamba Road currently, and we're going to have a look and check the carcass where those lions were feeding last night. Now, it seems as though we picked up on one male lion's tracks, which is probably the lion that Byron heard calling last night, going back towards sort of DRC itself, going back east. And it looks like he came all the way along Mamba Road. If I do find some more really nice tracks, I'll show you, because they're quite beautiful this morning as they've been pressed down after the rain. But it's a really nice clean track. It might actually be a good opportunity to have a look and spend some time looking at tracks today with all the nice wet solid ground. I think that'd be a good idea. I was just thinking for Jamie's moulds that would have been a really, really good lion footprint, and it's cast so nicely in the mud. Now, if that male lion has indeed walked along Mamba Road and didn't find the rest of the pride, I presume that's why he would have been calling. I wonder if the others are still around, which will be quite exciting to see. We're going to check this carcass on Mamba Road as well as the one that was deposited. Well, not deposited, we just found him lying in the middle of the block between Cheetah Cut Line and Drakensberg Road. We'll have a look over there too and see if any hyenas or any sort of scavenger activity is going on. I've already seen one vulture up ahead, it was flying, so I wonder what's going up there, but we're almost there. We're not too far away, hey David? No, we're just a couple of minutes away, just down the road. We're still going straight, eh? Yeah. I think we're going straight. Was it there? Oh, no, it is right, okay. Just always double checking because I'm still a little bit uncertain of the roads. Welcome, Nathaniel, and I hope you continue to watch the show. Good morning to you. Well, it's morning here in South Africa, Nathaniel. I'm not sure where you are from, but I hope you enjoy this morning's show. And you want to know if I've ever seen a lion kill anything while I've just been driving around. Actually, yes. In fact, the other morning, I was very lucky to come across the lions taking down a young buffalo calf. I just got there in the nick of time. They had just, there's lots of vultures here. This is exciting. Sorry, they'd actually just separated the calf from the herd. I'm just having a look. The vultures are probably going to fly, but I'm going to move away and then we're going to watch from a distance. I just want to get to the other side because clearly the lions are not here anymore. But let me give them a wide berth. Let me trick them and they must pretend and think I'm driving away. And let's park over here. Let's do this. Don't fly. Now there's only one hooded vulture left at this carcass, but I think we'll hang tight. Let's just sit here for a couple of moments and perhaps these vultures will go back down again. There we go. We've got a hooded vulture who says, I'm not scared of a silly little vehicle. Oh, I've just got to chat to Taxon quickly. Standing by, Taxon. Yeah, affirm. It comes all the way from Long Mamba Twin Dams towards Chelepan. I'm at that Filen Yari. There's just Makoti here off Mamba Road. So I'm just having a quick chat to Taxon. Just gonna let him know. Okay, I'm just listening to him. Sorry. Yeah, copy. No sign just yet. I think the Zingala moved before the rain, and I'll check carefully. So I'm a little bit uncertain as to how much rain we had last night, but it bucketed down. We had a massive downpour at about 10 o'clock last night or so. It started coming in, the thunder, and then by 10:30 we had hail, and it continued after the hail for a little bit longer, and it subsided. Everything is very wet, and it started raining again later. Now you can see these vultures have decided to tuck in. And hopefully the rest of them, they seem to be coming back now, which will be nice. They're coming into land. And it's quite funny that it was the hooded vulture that was the one to stick around. I always thought that the white-backed vultures were a little bit braver than the smaller hooded vulture. Now, at a carcass like this, and I'm sure you've heard it before, but perhaps like if you're like Nathaniel and you're watching for the first time, you're wondering how on earth do the vultures eat through that very tough hide of the buffalo? Now, there's a pecking order when it comes to vultures. There we go. Here comes another hooded vulture coming through. Now, like I said, there's a pecking order. So if you look at the beaks of the hooded vultures, you can see how slender they are. Now, unfortunately, they aren't able to pierce through the hide of a buffalo. So if it was a buffalo that had just died of natural causes, they would have to start eating it around the rump and pecking the eyes out and perhaps eating at the tongue until the big leopard-faced or even a white-backed vulture would come through with those strong, robust beaks and be able to tear open the carcass. Now, I always find that the hooded vultures seem to get bullied around the carcass, and maybe that's the reason why they hung around, is to try and take advantage of the lack of whitebacks and eat as much as they can before the whiteback vultures or leopard face come through and sort of chase them and bulldoze them out of the way. But remember, we are on a live safari, and myself and Byron would love to hear from you this morning. You're welcome to either hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you could even send us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. And you can hear all the birds waking up. I think they're quite happy that we had some rain. Excuse me. Thank you. That's beautiful. Also looking around, making sure no one else is coming through. Now, the lions are very spoilt that they don't really mind too much leaving half a buffalo behind. That's when you know that there is plenty of food around. In the summer months, we probably would not see this. We'd see the lions on a kill and finishing it until there was absolutely nothing left. Sure, you probably heard Rebecca there. Good morning, Rebecca, and good morning to you, Sandy. So, Sandy, you were wondering why the lions didn't finish the buffalo, and that's just it. There's just so much food around, and it seems as though the buffalo have unfortunately not done as well as what they could have with the rain. I sort of thought that they would have been able to bulk up enough to be able to survive, I suppose, what would you call it, like a little dry period again after we had the initial rain. But, I'm just listening. I can hear some elephants cracking trees in the distance. No, of course, now they've stopped. I'm hoping if we sit here for long enough, we'll get the rest of the vultures coming down to eat. You can see them flying in the distance, slowly coming back. Here comes some white-backed vultures, and now this is where the show will really begin. Yeah, they come running in. Come on, chase the hooded away. Three of them, three on three. Oh, absolutely love that hop and a skip that they do. Now, it would really be the cherry on top of my cake today if some hyenas came through. Oh, look at them having a little squabble as to who's going to get in first. And the white-backed vulture at the rear end is quite clever while everybody fights over the organs. It seems as though he's quite happy to stick his long head into the rump and start feeding on the intestines from that side. Efficient feeding. Now, these vultures are going to be absolutely ecstatic because there is so much meat on here. They really don't have to squabble, though they will, because vultures always do. Now, this is going to be a fantastic scene. The vultures are going to keep coming in, so keep your volume turned up loud. And as soon as they start to fight amongst each other and sort of produce dinosaur noises, well, then I'm going to sit very quietly and we're just going to watch and enjoy. Here they all come. One of my favorite sounds in the bush. my goodness. Look at those two battling it out for the prime spot. Now you can imagine, this is only but a handful of vultures now. They're going to keep coming in as the day progresses. And I'm even going to snap one or two shots because I haven't seen vultures on a carcass for ages. This is really beautiful. You would think it'd be more common. Now, speaking of sort of carcasses and hierarchies, a bird that I haven't seen sort of too often around here is a marabou stork. And I know that, sorry, Bex, go with that name. It was Trip somebody, sorry. Just Trip Edwards. There we go. Now, you are wondering where on earth do the marabou storks fit into the hierarchy. Now, because of their size, they're much taller and much larger and more powerful than the vultures that we often see, so predominantly the white-backed and, of course, the hooded. So a marabou would come through here and quite happily peck in between the vultures. You don't see it too often. I've only seen it a handful of times down in the southern sand where the marabous come and join in on the kills or the scavenging process. And when I was in Zambia, it was almost a given. It was almost as though the marabous used to get to the carcasses before the vultures did. We'd see them by the hundreds on the big open plains, feeding on the armored crickets. And then, of course, if something had died or if there was an opportunity to scavenge, they were there with the hornbills, which was quite amazing too. Is that the southern ground hornbills, I used to see them in Zambia scavenging quite significantly on all the various carcasses in and amongst the vultures and, of course, the marabou storks. Now, this is a real feast for these vultures. They're normally just used to eating a few little scraps here and there, you know, picking a few pieces in between the ribs. They have got an entire buffalo to eat. Now, the digestive system of vultures is quite amazing. They're very much like hyenas of the sky, I suppose. They don't really feed on any bone. They're just feeding on the flesh, and I'm sure occasionally they'll get the odd bit of hair. Now, I'm so sorry. I keep missing all the names this morning. My brain is doing about 360. Sorry, Rebecca. Robin. And now my voice is disappearing from me. Robin, you were wondering, let's just have a look. Oh, you see there's a couple more sitting over here. You were wondering if the vultures also cast pellets, for instance, like an owl, for example. Now, they don't. They just defecate normally. It's quite a large amount of feces that they deposit, and it's something that I always say, and my trackers have always said over the years, is don't park underneath a vulture. You wouldn't want to be defecated on, especially after what we see them eating. And you can see them all sitting up. Those two look to be quite full. They don't seem to be too bothered and interested in squabbling. Just calling another vehicle in, because this is quite amazing to see, just to be able to spend a little bit of time with these vultures at this sort of feeding frenzy. Right, we might hang around here for a little bit longer. Perhaps we'll quickly go and check the other buffalo carcass and see what's happening. But while I do that, let's go back across to Byron and just get a little update from him.
Interesting to see so much vulture activity around. We're still having a good look. Here we go, got something here for you. Off to the left, beautiful giraffe. Oh, that's a nice surprise. Big male. I haven't had any sign of any predators just yet. No tracks. Oh, this could be interesting. This giraffe trying to get down a bit of an embankment. I think it's just going to feed on that tree. That's interesting. Thought perhaps he might try and go all the way down. Let me just try to see something. Now, that is very interesting because that giraffe is feeding on a tree known as a tambwati. And sorry, I'm just listening to a lilac-breasted roller that's been upset by something. But getting back to the giraffe feeding on the tambwati tree. Now, the tambwati tree is actually very poisonous. Now, some animals are able to digest the leaves and it doesn't affect them. I know, though, that for us humans, if we even just make a fire using the wood of the tambwati tree, the smoke inhalation can cause some serious sickness. You often get really bad stomach ailments, and it will cause nausea and headaches. So it's really, really not great for us at all. And it's amazing how, I can't remember the last time I saw a giraffe feeding on one, but I know kudu also feed on them, and black rhino, surprisingly, also like to feed on tambwati leaves. So I don't know why it doesn't affect them, or if they've just built up an immunity to some of the poison, or if their digestive system is that much different to ours. But I know if we make a fire and we use the wood of the tambwati tree, it is not good at all. Listen, I want you to hear something. Let's see if we can hear it just behind the giraffe. Can you hear that whistling? That is a little pearl-spotted owl. I wonder if we can find it. It's a tiny, tiny owl. Just calling in this drainage line. But to find that is very, very difficult. I'm going to scan with my binoculars a little bit in those trees. I've actually found him. Can you believe it? Oh, it just flew off. Hang on. It just flew to the back in that very large tree directly behind the giraffe. He was in there. We'll just have a quick scan again. Just saw it as it took off. Hang on. Oh, I can't believe it. I think we've just missed it. Calling again, listen to that whistle. Let me try to find a picture for you quickly to show you. And I don't have my book with me this morning because of all the rain last night. We took it out. I don't want all our stuff getting wet. But I have got my bird app with me. And you can have a look over here. That's the pearl-spotted owl. Beautiful little owl. Look at that. And very, very, very small. One of the smallest little owls that we get out here. So a bird, well, the pearl-spotted owl is probably only about this big. So very, very small. And it's one of the smallest owls that we get in this area. We have this one and another little bird, or another little owl known as the Scops owl, which is slightly smaller, also only about this size. But they've got amazingly loud calls. Hang on, what's that sitting up there? No. I just want to have a look in this drainage line quickly. I don't think that bird flew off too far. This giraffe is still feeding just on the edge of the thicket. On the edge of the drainage line. Let's just take a drive down and have a look here quickly. Maybe we still lucky and we find that little owl. It's funny, often, even though they're no direct threat to other birds, lots of other birds mob them and chase them away. Deanna or Diana would like to know if we perhaps might have some water in the drainage lines because of all the rain last night. Deanna, there's a good possibility. I've seen some pools already that have formed along the sides of the roads, but I still think we'd need a lot more rain. You can see it's a little bit wet through here. Let's just have a look. But the water hasn't actually gathered around. Just see some mud. Oh, that bird is very, very close. Let's just have a look here. Let's just have a quick look around the corner. Didn't sound too far at all. Possibly in these trees just off to the right. Hold on. Let's have a quick look here. Let me just scan for 2 seconds, see if I can find it for you. Again, because of their size, they're not very easy to spot, but the shape does stand out quite a little bit. Okay, we're going to carry on searching here just for a little bit. While I do that, Taylor's got some large animals she would like to show you.
Not only do we have some large animals, I want you all to turn your volume up because I can see hear the southern ground hornbills calling in the distance. Now they have stopped. Wonderful. Very typical, but they don't think they're too far away from us, so perhaps we'll try and relocate them. Now, these are the elephants that I heard in the distance pushing the tree over. They indeed did push a tree over. I'm just having a little look around, trying to figure out if I can see any more vultures or hear any hyenas perhaps on that kill that's off-road. See, I'm a bit reluctant to go off the road today. I was chatting to another guide and it sounds like they had about 30 mils of rain or so, and I think we probably had about 20 mils of rain. I don't want to off-road too much and too unnecessarily, of course, otherwise we're just going to damage all the vegetation. So let's carry on. Let's see if we can perhaps pick up. Here we go, we have another look. One last glimpse of this elephant as his friends have all disappeared. Now, the elephants aren't far away from that carcass at all. I know Marie was wondering if those elephants, if they were to come across a carcass, would they leave immediately? Would they perhaps sort of have a look at it? Now, naturally, elephants are inquisitive creatures. So they would probably go up to it, especially if it was a group of males like we're looking at here. They might go up and have a little feel and a smell. It's not always that they will just move away. Maybe if it's a family and there's young calves and they can smell that the lions have been around, they probably just keep going. They don't want to run the risk of something potentially happening to a calf. But now you can see this elephant is not disappearing into the distance. And off he goes. Well, if he's going to go, then we will go too. And let's have another little look. I'm going to do a little sort of circle around this area and just see if I can't pick up any tracks of those lions coming out. I haven't seen anything just yet. And perhaps if they don't, that may mean that they either moved before the rain, which would be quite difficult to try and track them, especially with the amount of rain we had. It would have easily wiped away any trace that those animals even crossed that area. So we'll have to look very carefully. And then, of course, it could be another indication that maybe they are in this block with that carcass. And we'll just have a little quick little look around here. Let's do a quick loop. Maybe we can see something as we gaze in. Otherwise, I'm going to have to go for a little walk and head on foot inside that block and just have a little look-see instead of taking a vehicle straight through there. If it was dry, it would be all right. Like I said, but we've had a lot of water. The ground is now very soft. I don't want to leave and make a permanent track for no reason. Well, the elephants have been working really hard here. They've been ploughing up all the land, and I suppose they're a bit like farmers. And always seem to make a big mess after the rain, digging. The ground is a lot softer. And I don't think it's too bad. It's like what buffalo do when they move over massive grasslands. Oh yeah, I'm also just checking into the bush here. I'm just looking, trying to see if I can see anything. Is that when the buffalo sort of go over a big area and there has been quite a lot of rain, they sort of mulch with their feet, and it's very much the same as ploughing, and it stimulates the new growth of the grass. I can smell that buffalo, but let's go back across to Byron and see what type of swimming pool he's got.
We found some kudu walking around, and they were heading, look at that, there was one drinking at a small little pool of water which has formed during the evening. I'll show you that shortly, but look at this female, still quite wet from all the rain last night. There's another one behind her. And then have a look at this little, that's the male, a young male. And he was drinking at this water hole, or this little pan that has formed just off to the left. Have a look at that. So some serious rain that's enough to fill some of these water holes. We're interested to see what's happened at Biffleshook Dam. So we're heading in that direction. We didn't have any luck with that little owl. Let's just have a look here too. There's also another kudu coming off to our left, some impala in the background. Oh, let's keep quiet. This one looks like it might come and drink. I'm just going to sit quietly for a second. Oh, fantastic. That is really, really great. And that young one. See, that's one of the wonderful things about having so much rain in an evening like this. You get these little pans, little pools that form. And all the animals are able to get a drink much easier now. It's almost like a bit of relief from these dry conditions that we've had. That's wonderful. Look at them just sipping up that water. You can see they're still very wary of us. Those big ears facing us. They want to make sure we're not a threat. But they seem very comfortable with us being here. I mean, for them to go down and drink while we are so close. It's fantastic. That was lovely. Oh, wonderful. So the kudu are walking off. We're going to continue. And Taylor's got some more birds for you.
We're having a great birding morning today. We've stumbled across a beautiful tawny eagle. I think this could be the first one that I've seen that's actually sat still and not flown away. Well, they can be easily confused between the stepped eagle, which is slightly more larger, but one of the ways that I use to tell the difference between sort of the two species is that If you have a look at their sort of feathers, their color of their feathers, you can see that this tawny eagle is very much tawny and more of a yellowy color, whereas a stepped eagle is sort of the darker brown feathers that you see towards the wings. That's sort of typically what you will see on a stepped eagle. And otherwise they look fairly similar. And this one's just having a little look, perhaps waiting for an opportunity to head around and scavenge. Now, I didn't go in yet. I didn't get to go in just yet to have a look at that buffalo carcass. I'm just doing a loop to double check that there's no tracks coming in or out. And, well, we came across this tawny eagle. I'll try and show you a picture of a stepped eagle. I need to dig my book out, though. Right, let's see where you are. Isn't that beautiful? At least the sky is not too grey. Normally the birds always get lost in the back when you have a grey backdrop. A rose eagle? No, we're not looking for that one. Palm nut vulture? Nope, not that one either. Perhaps I've gone too far. Tawny, where are ya? Let's see where all the eagles are. Tawny eagles over there. Sorry, there we go. Okay, let's have a look now. I'm going to show you very quickly in my book about the stepped eagle on the top. And you see it all the way over here? Yes, if you go to the left though, you'll be able to see the bird better. There we go. You can see what I mean when I say it's much darker in color. And then if you go down a little bit further, you can see the juvenile. And perhaps you could get a little bit confused with a tawny eagle and a juvenile stepped eagle. Though I don't think the tawny eagles have that sort of white barring that you can see just on the tip of the wings over there, as prominent as the stepped eagle does when it's a juvenile. Let's see. Oh, it's actually having a little look at us. This is quite a beautiful and relaxed tawny eagle. Oh, it's giving a little call. Now it's grooming itself. Perhaps this eagle did get a little bit wet and is now trying to dry its feathers. You can see it's all ruffled up, hoping that the air is going to get through and just dry each feather over the next few minutes, constantly fluttering its wings and pulling out all the little feathers that don't need to be there anymore. But isn't that beautiful? And something else that is typical of an eagle is that they have feathers all the way down to their feet. It might be difficult to see though, because we've got half of the tree blocking the view of the eagle. But I don't want to move too much in case it does fly away. There we go, but you can see the lovely feathers going all the way down its legs now that it's moved out a little bit. And the only real exception to that rule is the African fish eagle. Now, if an African fish eagle were to have feathers down on its legs when it stuck its feet in the water while it was trying to catch a fish, it would probably do a somersault and land in the water. So it needs to have smooth legs in order to not end up face first in an ocean, in a dam, or wherever it may be flying around. Isn't that beautiful? Like I say, whenever we have these cloudy days, and normally when we have a bit of rain, we always have it seems to be the best birding weather. Now, there's not too much difference between the male and female. I'm unsure of the sex of this bird. The females tend to be a little bit larger, and off it goes into the distance, than the males, but not by too much. And they're not a particularly big bird. They don't weigh more than about 2 kilograms. But a fairly long wingspan. And off it goes. Fantastic. Now we've seen some vultures just up at the top of the tree, just up ahead. Let's continue a little bit further and see why they are sitting up in the tree. And of course I am dangling my head off the side of the vehicle. And that's just me looking for the tracks of the lions to see and try and figure out where on earth they've gone. We've got vultures everywhere. There they go. I'm not going to particularly stop too much for them. They're just flying. Bye-bye. Tawny eagle again is going to disappear. Or maybe not. Maybe we can actually get one last front look at this tawny eagle. That's very nice, but now it's gone. Off it goes into the distance. And you can hear Jigger's got particularly squeaky brakes today. But it's what gives her character. Oof, that's very nice. It's amazing how quickly they go. Beautiful. It's not every day that we get to spend some valuable time with these beautiful birds. Now I wonder if this tawny eagle is perhaps not quite an adult just yet. When it was flying, it exposed some beautiful mottling white feathers on its body, and that's not 100% typical, and it does take the adults a long, well, to reach adulthood it takes a long time. It can take up to 4 years, so perhaps this tawny eagle is just getting its adult feathers now. Ooh. Bobby Chairs, speaking about eagles, you want to know if we have any hawks as well. We've got an array of different hawks. The most common one is probably the African harrier hawk, or a gymnogene is the old name. And then of course there's another one which we've been seeing quite a bit of, and that is the African hawk eagle. Let me show you very quickly in my book. It will only take me just a moment. I think I'm starting to manage my book now after 5 years. I'm just joking. Pages are stuck together in this book. It's one of my older books, so I'm just trying to find it here. Right, eagles. We need to go past the big eagles and we need to get to the smaller ones. I've got the first one though. There is hawk eagle. Have a look over here. And it's probably one of my favorite hawks, I suppose. Beautiful. They're very lovely, very white with a black crown on their head. And let's just go over to the next page to show you the African hawk eagle. Not the African hawk eagle. Yes, the African hawk eagle. Where are you? Gymnogene? Oh, I think I've seen it. Sorry, I've got 150 million pages I need to try and get through. Now, where are you? We very quickly need to show you. No, not working. Okay, I'm going to have to search through it. Oh, no, here it is. African harrier hawk, sorry. Not hawk eagle, I've already showed you that one. Which is a bird we typically find climbing around knob thorns looking for snakes and scorpions and all sorts of things to feed on. There we go, Bobby Chairs. So those are the two most common ones that you can have a look out for, that we see sort of on a regular basis. But I think it's time to go back to Byron, and he wants to do a little tour with you.
I would like to do a bit of a tour, a dam tour. Look how full this dam is. We're at Biffles Hook Dam at the moment. And look at all the water. This is fantastic. Do you think yesterday it was bone dry? There was just a little pool. And Douglas from Arizona, I know you wanted to have a look at the dams to see how much water there is. Isn't this fantastic? All these impala around here, they've all come down to drink. There's lots of water here for all the animals. This is great. So hopefully we get some regrowth. I've spotted a few other animals on the other side of the dam, opposite us in that direction. Let's have a look down there at the base of that tree. I saw some monkeys moving around. There we go. One or two up in there, like vervet monkeys. Wow. A few of them around. It's nice to see monkeys around. They've probably come down to drink too. And just getting ready to start their day. The monkeys are incredibly alert animals, and the amount of times we've found predators just by going on monkey alarm calls is incredible. So their eyesight is very, very good, so they can see any predator from quite far away, probably a lot sooner than we can. And then they'll alarm call. They give off this very interesting alarm call. I'll see if I can do it for you. It sounds something like And that is my attempt at a monkey, a vervet monkey alarm call. And usually when that alarm call is then to alert the rest of the troop and make sure they know that there's danger around and that there's a potential predator. So if you find them and you just watch where these monkeys are looking, which direction they're looking on, if they are alarm calling, chances are you're probably going to find what they have seen. So great help in finding any predators. Baboons too. Baboons also, they don't like any predators around and they can give off some serious alarm calls. But theirs is a loud bark. Bow! Bow! And that will alert you then too to some predators around. But I'm so happy to see how much water there is in the dam at the moment. It's fantastic. Really is great. Look at that. That is incredible. Just from one evening of good rain. But like we said, we need more. We need more rain. And hopefully in the next few weeks, we'll get a lot more. This dam could possibly fill up a lot more. I think they've prepared for a lot more water to arrive in this dam. So hopefully over the next few weeks, few months, we'll get a lot more rain. This dam will fill up nicely. Probably find a lot more hippo coming to these areas. And a lot of animals then coming down to drink at these big water holes. But that is really, really wonderful. All right, so let us continue and see what else we can find. Still haven't had any tracks, and I wonder if you see what often happens is after rain like this, the ground hardens slightly. It gets this little crust. In certain areas, the ground can be so hard it's difficult to see tracks, unless it's in a muddy section. So, like up here on the dam wall at the moment, I doubt we'd see any tracks if we had to go and have a look around here, because the soil is very sandy, very coarse, and very hard. Let's look down here. And I know Taylor had a lot of vulture activity around, and I think it's because of yesterday. All those various buffalo carcasses that we found, well, the lions had killed one or two, and there were some others, just really old, sick buffalo that I think were dying. So there's going to be a lot of vulture activity, I think, for the next few days. I've heard, hang on, there's a cuckoo calling somewhere. Just wait, where's this cuckoo? Sounds like a Levalent cuckoo. There's also a red-chested cuckoo calling. We've been trying to show you a cuckoo for the last few days, so I'm having a good look around. Let's see, maybe, but it stopped calling now. Murphy's Law, as you hear them and you think you've got an idea of which direction they are, they disappear. And they stop calling. Let me see if I can find one of these cuckoos for you. While I do that, Taylor's got more vultures that she'd like to show you.
It seems the only thing that wants to show itself to us today are the birds, which is fine with me. We haven't really had a big birding day for quite some time. I normally seem to do them when Brent is always around. He always challenges me into birding days. Perhaps Byron and I will have to do one in the next few days. Now, this is the same carcass that we were at earlier. We're getting a dead stare. Sorry, that was very funny to watch how that vulture was looking straight towards us with their big beady eyes. And it seems as though the white-backed are not the bravest. They keep flying away as soon as anybody comes in and out, and the hooded vultures don't really seem to mind so much. All the flies starting to come through and settle in on the carcass. Thank you. Lots of birds chatting in the distance. Now, me and my cat, you would like to know this morning if the vultures will either spread out and feed on the various carcasses, or would they perhaps just feed on one and then move to the next once they're finished? Now, it just depends. I don't know if the other buffalo carcass has been spotted yet. There were quite a few trees growing over the top of it. Sorry, some big marulas. I'm probably going to sneeze again at some point, so I'm just going to apologize in advance. So I think that they would probably just eat whichever one they found first. Remember yesterday we saw those vultures in the distance and I couldn't remember where the carcass was, the really stinky one that was covered in maggots. And it seems as though the vultures had already tucked into that one, and I wouldn't be surprised with all the lion activity around here if the vultures aren't starting to follow the lions because they've become so successful. But nobody else seems to be coming back now. Well, hooded vultures, you've got this entire buffalo to yourselves. You better make the most of it. Now, there's normally a bit of argument, or quite a bit of arguments that go around at a carcass like this. Now, Dustin, you're wondering if the vultures would defend the carcass from any other predators that come through. And unfortunately, not really. If the hyenas even come charging in, the vultures will all sort of scatter and fly. And of course, if the lions come, well, the first thing they're going to do is fly straight up to the nearest tree and then sit and watch in envy. But let's have another little look. I'm quite interested to see where... Sorry, they're all feeding. Because it doesn't seem to be... like they're freely feeding on too much. I wonder what sort of size of a gash that lioness made in the stomach last night. It was an awkward position. We couldn't see very well. But I don't see them pulling out any sort of big chunks of flesh. I'm not even sure if the lions pulled the organs out. Perhaps they've already been eaten. I love it when they look at you like that. Those beautiful big eyes. And that pink facial skin, that eye really does pop. And look at the beautiful colors on this vulture's feather. The mottled dark browns and the blacks and the lighter browns with the speckles of white. That is quite pretty. This is absolutely amazing. I could sit here the entire day. Oh, this is so exciting. Well, I better quickly send you off to Byron because he's got one of the fastest creatures in the world.
Look what we found, everybody. Have a look at this. Look what we found. Got a little Speke's hinged-back tortoise. This is great. Hello, little guy. What I wanted to show you is just the carapace. This one's covered in mud. It looks like it's actually buried itself, and that's usually what these tortoises do in the winter. They bury themselves so that they conserve the energy, conserve moisture, so they'll dig maybe into these. This is a bit of a drainage line behind us into the banks of this dry riverbed or drainage line, and you can see it's completely covered in sand and mud. So after this rain, they start getting a bit more active. They dig themselves out. They start moving around. Now this is different to the leopard tortoise in that it's much smaller and the carapace or the shell is not as round. Now the leopard tortoise gets that beautiful rounded shell. This one's a lot flatter and more elongated, and you can see there's actually a hinge at the back of the shell, and that's where it gets its name, the Speke's hinged back tortoise. This is fantastic. Little shy, let's see if he comes out and starts moving again. He's a little bit shy with me being so close to him, so we'll leave him, but what a nice surprise. See, that's the joy about this rain that we had. You get all these interesting little animals that come out. And, you know, we've been speaking about chameleons and other reptiles, maybe snakes. And we just need to, I think with this rain now, you might start seeing a lot more activity from those animals. So you've always got to be very careful when driving around, especially in summer, because you get these little tortoises and that on the side of the road or in the road. You don't want to drive over them. That's great. Lovely little surprise. Let's see if Taylor's got an update from that carcass that she was at.
We have moved off from the carcass now, because I really want to try and find the Nkuhumas. We know that that carcass is probably just going to get more and more active as the day goes on. So I don't think it'll be the last time that we pop back past there, but maybe in an hour or so. But let's carry on though and see if we can figure out where on earth these lions have gone. And I'm not sure exactly what to do, because I can see so many impala. There's just herds and herds of impala in this sort of area where that second carcass would have been or is. So I don't think that there would be, you know, quite a few impala hanging around if they were right near the lions. Like I said, I don't want to go in with a vehicle. So I think we'll leave it. And I sat there and listened very quietly when we were with the elephants a little bit earlier, because that carcass was probably about 60 or 70 meters off the road and just in the block, and I didn't hear anything. I didn't hear the squabbling of vultures or hyenas, and I most certainly didn't hear anything on the lions. So I think we'll just check the perimeter, we'll just check the boundary, and I'm also going to keep chatting to Taxon this morning, who's also on the search for any of the cats, really. Maybe we'll just double check around here. And I think we'll carry on right until before sort of cut line, along cheetah cut line. Seems as though somebody else has also driven here, but they didn't hear anybody else calling any other lion tracks. I'm very envious that Byron has managed to find a tortoise, and I'm sure you probably got very excited and maybe thought you were about to see a cheetah when I said one of the fastest animals in this world. Of course, I was only joking. But it was nice to see a tortoise. We don't often get to see them. I was very excited. And this morning, David and I were chatting to each other saying what we'd like to see. I obviously said I want to see the Nkuhumas catching a buffalo, because that seems like it's possible at the moment with their success rate. Ooh, that was a very big bump. There's a lot of erosion, I apologize, going on after all that rain. And half of that little donga we went over has eroded and we couldn't see it from the other side. Now, my request I thought was a little bit sort of easier to perhaps see than David's. David's was absolutely ridiculous. David requested this morning that he wants to see an elephant giving birth. I mean, how ridiculous is that? I don't know if we're going to see that happen, but it would be nice. I wouldn't say no. I would happily eat some humble pie if we were to come across an elephant giving birth. Still no tracks along here, and the sand is nice and soft. And I would even presume if they had walked here before the rain, I think you would still have seen a little sort of part. There's something moving up in the distance. I think it looks like wildebeest or zebra. But before we get there, it's still a little way away. Let's go back to Byron, who's got a bird for you.
While Taylor is in search of buffalo, we've found another beautiful bird, a brown hooded kingfisher. And he's calling wonderfully for us. Look at that, the brown hooded kingfisher. Now this kingfisher does not migrate. This is here throughout the year. And this kingfisher, surprisingly enough, despite the name, feeds on insects. So you don't really see them close to waterholes. You'll find them in the bush, especially around drainage lines where we are at the moment, in an area right along the edge of a drainage line. And they'll feed and catch insects. beautiful bird. The birds are calling so much this morning. It's been a fantastic morning for birds. I keep hearing the owls, the little pearl-spotted owls. Again, there was one calling just off to our left. There's a lot of cuckoos, crested barbets, a hoopoe. There's so much going on at the moment. I saw something move just down beyond us over here. I just want to have a look. Look like an inyala. Have a look down here. Oh, where did it go? Yeah, there's a male inyala. Have a look through there. There goes the one. That's what you saw. There was another one behind it. Let's see if it follows. Just moved down into this drainage line, and then look at the whole group off to the left of females. All these females, and look how different they are, the male compared to those females. Almost look like they're two different different species. Females are that reddish brown coloration with the white stripes, and that male, there's a young male. The male, they have those dark gray coats. Very different looking, but beautiful antelope. There's the adult male. Look at him. Really beautiful. James Bears asked a question about the birds that we've got around here, and he wanted to know, is there another bird that I know of that has got such a harsh call like the lilac-breasted roller, but is so colorful? And James, thinking about it now, I can't really. All the other really colorful birds have got quite a melodious call. I wonder. The Narina trogon, now that I think about it, let me see if I can find that for you quickly on my trusty bird app. I'd like to show you this bird because it is really, really beautiful. And the trogon also has, I wouldn't say quite a harsh call, but a very deep call for this bird. And let me show you quickly. Have a look at that. Can you see there, Volley? Look at that color, that Narina trogon. I'm just going to scroll for you quickly, because that picture doesn't do it any justice. But look at that. There we go, let me turn it like that. Look at that coloration of that bird. Now, I have seen them in the Sabi Sands, in this area that we are in, but they do prefer quite dense, thicker areas. And especially down towards the coast, the east coast of South Africa. But they also have a very, very harsh, very, very harsh call. I'm actually going to see, let me see, these apps actually have the bird calls on them. So let me see if I can play it and if you can hear it. And let's see. Can you hear that? Very deep, booming sound. Hang on. Red-chested cuckoo, everyone, up in the top of the tree. Yes, we got one. Red-chested cuckoo, yes. Look at that. Really beautiful. I hope all our very keen birders are watching, because this is awesome. We hear them all the time, but to see them is really difficult. Listen to that call. Stopped again, obviously. Let's just watch it. Whoa, fantastic. Speaking about one bird, and another bird arrives, and what a beautiful bird it is. There it goes. And red-chested cuckoo. That was great. That was really fantastic. Awesome. We've said we wanted to show you a cuckoo, and we found one, and it's one of my favorite because of that call. That beautiful, beautiful call. So James, you know, I'm thinking about a harsh call, a beautiful bird or beautiful coloured bird with a harsh call. I still think the lilac-breasted roller wins, but that Narina Trogon is a very deep sound call you wouldn't expect to come from such a beautiful bird. And how wonderful was it to see that red-chested cuckoo? Still haven't seen any tracks of any predators just yet, not on our side at least. So we're going to continue searching in this area. Taylor's also searching. Let's see if she's found anything yet.
Haven't found anything at the moment. We're still looking for the lions, but I did have a lovely conversation with Jackson and he's provided some valuable information this morning. But before I tell you about that, let's have a look at these African grey hornbills calling up in the top of that tree. That's quite nice. Good morning, hornbills. And almost the only species of hornbill that doesn't like to sit still and be shown on camera. There we go. Isn't that beautiful? Now, when I was learning birds, this call was probably one of the most difficult to learn. The reason being is because the call sounds quite similar to most of the raptors. So the birds of prey, they normally have those high-pitched calls like that. And you'd often get confused, but now it's unmistakable. Having a great chat with each other. And I can hear some more calling in the far distance, so perhaps these two are proclaiming their territory. It looks like it's the male on the left with a little bit more of a crown and the female on the right. If you're having a look at their beaks, you can tell the difference between the two. Very vocal this morning. Huh? Are you going to fly? Are you going to stay? They're very uncertain. Well, isn't this amazing? Normally it's quite difficult to tell the difference between various birds, but I think the hornbills probably are the easiest out of them all. And that's really just if you look at their beaks, of course, how robust they are. Now, I'm not sure why they are so much bigger than the females. I think it's possibly the only reason I could really think of is that it's really just for display, you know, to sort of make himself look prettier, because their colors are exactly the same colored feathers, and they're relatively the same size. So of course you need something, like a male lion has a big mane. I think the beak is of course the most prominent thing that's on the top of their face that you see straight away from a hornbill. So it would make sense that that would be the way that you could tell the difference between the two. Sometimes it can be a bit tricky though. We were seeing at one point lots and lots of yellow-billed hornbills, all the males hanging around together. And I think that was because they were fighting sort of for territories and for mates. But now we're back to normal again. We're seeing a male and a female together. So it's not too confusing. So what I was about to tell you before we spotted those hornbills was that Taxon said he had some tracks of the lions around the dam, around Gowri Dam, where the dam cam is, last night. But I know that the Nkuhumas aren't too fond of the rain. And like I said, there was a lot of hail last night, so I'm sure they would have gone into a drainage line to look for some shelter. We even had a whole lot of buffalo almost inside camp last night. They were hanging around on the outside of the fence. And I reckon if we'd left the gate open, they probably would have come outside or parked themselves in under one of the garages where we keep the cars to try and avoid the rain. Oh, very squeaky, sorry about that. So my plan from here is to go onto Central and to go around and to have a look from sort of east to west and see if we can't find them there. It's warming up beautifully now. There's not a breath of wind. The skies are becoming nice and blue. So perhaps they'll come out from their hiding spots. Just double checking here. Nope. Well, we're coming up to Bivelzoek Dam. I know you've just had a look at it, but I'd quite like to have a little glimpse and see what we're going to be dealing with for this afternoon. Oh my goodness, it's like a lake. It's massive. Just having a little quick glimpse of it as we go through this last drainage. That is so beautiful, but I'll show you again before we carry on. Ooh, around the corner we go. Let's just double check. Oh my goodness, it really is a lake. Well, this is so spectacular. All the impala coming down to drink now. No hippos. I'd be in here. Smells like there were some hippos though. Oh, we go a bit further back. Yeah. Isn't that lovely? There, they're impala having a nice drink. Now you can see how dirty the water is. If it was clean, it would have been a crystal clear reflection, but unfortunately from all the hippo feces and buffalo feces and elephant urine and you name it that is in this water, it's sort of got that murky foamy coat to the top. But now that we've had some rain, perhaps that water would have been sort of re-oxygenated again, and that's one of the biggest problems when the dams and watering holes start to dry out, is that you get a lot of bacteria in that water and eventually there's just not enough oxygen for the little organisms to live in it. But that would have done them fine. It seems as though the geese are enjoying themselves though. They've got actual pools to swim in now. You can see them. So these are filter feeders, and most of the ducks and geese are indeed filter feeders. So what that means is that you can see how that bird is sort of clattering its bill together. You see that? And little particles are entering its mouth, and it has almost like a sieve, and it will then catch up all the delicious little particles. But they'll also eat grass. Egyptian geese, you often see them out in the middle of nowhere where there's no water to be found. Grazing, they're big grazers, and also big pests, unfortunately, in South Africa. I think I've mentioned this. They tend to plague the golf courses, and you can imagine why, especially if they like to eat grass. Those fairways will be beautiful, perfect sort of breeding habitat for them. Now, I've never ever found an Egyptian goose nest before, and it's something that I've always tried to have a look for. But when I was down in the Eastern Cape, it was quite funny how the Egyptian geese seem to like to use the termite mounds, sort of on top of the termite mounds, and use them as a nesting site. I never got to see one, but I just heard all the other guides talking about it, and of course I saw lots and lots of photos. But perhaps if this happy couple stick around in the area, then maybe I will be able to see that. Oh, I'm so sorry, Mariana. I'll repeat the bird's name for you. These are Egyptian geese, and there's actually a pair of them sort of wading through the water. They're very common. Like I said, you see them all over, not just out here in the wild. They've become quite accustomed to parks and golf courses. They love those areas. You sort of live between them, and I know that the local people enjoy eating Egyptian goose. It's a staple diet sort of around this area. If they can catch one, it's sort of a nice delicacy that they could feed on. Oh, I'm sure there's lots and lots of goodies for these Egyptian geese to eat in this water. Now I wonder how deep it is. I wonder if their webbed feet are touching the bottom as they're paddling along. Now I hope we're going to have a hot day, that we definitely need to have an absolute scorcher like it was yesterday afternoon, and I think that this watering hole would be fantastic. We may even if it sticks around for long enough, we may even get to see elephants swimming again. Well, not the big ones, but the little ones will probably be able to submerge themselves and have a little bit of fun. And that's what's so exciting, is that when you have a bit of rain and it fills up the water, the watering pans like this one. Look at that. I mean, yesterday there was nothing. There was maybe a meter of water or so in the far top corner, and now it's completely filled up. This is so lovely. Right, but let's carry on. Let's continue our search for the Nkuhumas. So we're going to probably head down Inyala Road. I think that's going to be our best bet. I want to try and check as far east on Central as I can and then sort of head around. I did check a little bit of Central around Drakensberg Junction and we didn't see anything around there. We'll have to head to the next one. Now I know sometimes going along this road, the signal can be a little bit jumpy, but let's go across to Byron in case I disappear. And it seems as though he's got himself stuck in the mud.
So we've just we're doing a bit of a dam tour again this morning, but I just wanted to stop and show you this this little drainage line. You can see how this water is filled up here. So this, obviously the catchment in this area must be a lot better. It's incredible. Just to think, yesterday we drove through here and there was no water at all. So it really is wonderful to see. We're going to carry on. Just up ahead is this twin dams, and let's see how much water is in there. And maybe there's some animals lying around, you never know. A lot of impala wandering around. A little dacre just darted off. They're always very, very shy and skittish, and they tend to move off very, very quickly. Let's see here. I wonder if this has filled up much. A little bit, not too much. We'll have a look now. We'll stop. Yeah, actually very little. So maybe the catchment in this area isn't as good. It's filled up a little bit, but there was always some water in there. Right, we're now going to head towards what's the other Treehouse Dam? Almost forgot the name there for a second, and see what we can find around there. While I head to that dam, Taylor's got some birds that are trying to make a home.
So have a look there. You can see that hornbill has just landed on this dead tree. Can you see it back there? Now it's very difficult to make out what they're doing, but they're actually building a nest, and this is quite spectacular. Now we know how the hornbills like to nest. They find a hole or a cavity in a tree, and the female will go inside when she's laid her clutch of eggs, and then the male will start to close the hole up. They do work together. You can see the one just on top there. So for the initial sort of mudding up of the walls or closing up of the hole, they will both sort of collect mud and sort of start pushing it around the outside of the hole. And just before it gets too small, let's see if he's going to come here to this puddle of water in front of us. I suspect that it will. then the female will jump inside and the male will continue working. Now let's have a look here, let's watch this. I've never seen them building a nest before. I think the nest is on the other side of the tree though, but it's still amazing just to see them out and collecting their nesting material. Look, come back here, there's lots of nice mud this side. You can see that their bills are also nice and brown from probing them into the ground. Not looking for insects or anything. They, like I said, they're collecting mud. Here we go. Are you going to take that back with you? Yes. Flying all the way back to the dead tree. Now the dead, it's back on the tree. There he is. See, so I think the nest is just on the other side, just out of sight for us. And it's amazing how, like back in the day, well, there's still some indigenous people that make mud huts. And this is a technique that these birds are still using. We'll sit here for a little bit because they every now and then keep coming to this puddle of water. And the reflection is quite beautiful. There we go, got some more mud. Now, sort of the species of hornbills that we seem to see are the red-billed, the yellow-billed, and of course the southern ground. Now, Fuzzman Sparkles also wants to know if we perhaps see crowned hornbills. Occasionally we do. We really do see them, but not very often. Even when I was down in the south, there we go, that's a big bit of mud. I only saw them about 5 times or so, and I saw them down closer towards the river. If there are any big fig trees that are around and are fruiting well, then you're definitely going to see crowned hornbills. They will always be in those trees with all the African green pigeons. But I haven't really seen any fig trees. I don't think I've seen one fig tree since I've been here. But they typically like to grow on the banks of rivers. And I know we don't have any big river systems up in this northern sector. Well, any of the areas that we really have to traverse on. Well, I suspect, I don't know, I may have to have a chat with Brent to see if he's seen the odd crowned hornbill, but I can imagine it would be a special sighting up here in the north. Now let's see if they're going to come back again. But this is really just quite amazing just to sit here and be able to watch all these things happen. Now Emma, you want to know if these birds are made for life. They are indeed monogamous. So they will try and find the same mate and will stick together for as long as possible. Obviously if one dies or something happens, they're not going to just not do anything about it. They will then start searching for a new partner. Let's see when they are. I think they're just jumping in around on the ground below the tree. Now, Virginia, you've asked a fantastic question. You want to know, if something happened to the male, and say perhaps when that female was already inside her little cavity and she'd been sort of blocked up, would that female leave the nest to find food? I think she'd have to. Because I think if she didn't, she would unfortunately probably starve sitting in there. She really relies on that male to pass through food through a small little hole that they leave open with the mud. And I think that she would have to break her way out and then continue and perhaps abandon the eggs or try and incubate them, but maybe they won't get enough incubation. So I'm not so sure. I haven't heard of anything like that, but of course there's a possibility that hornbill could just be out for a day. An eagle could take it down. A caracal, any one of the smaller predators could actually take it. Are they coming back? They're coming closer again. I'm going to sit very quietly now. There we go. Pecking lovely at that soft mud and taking it back again. That's a beautiful reflection. So you can see that that's lovely fresh water in that little wallow. I may even take one or two photos. I hope you are doing the same thing. One of my favorite things that I love to do is, of course, photography. And I know, Becca, you would prefer to be out here on the vehicle with me taking lots of photos, but you can do even better. You can take lots of screenshots and share them with all of us. And remember, it's always nice to share those photos because perhaps somebody has just started watching and has missed out on quite a bit of the show already, so it's nice to do a little catch-up with them. Remember, you can do that by either hashtagging Safari Live on Twitter or sending us an email at questions@wildearth.tv. I think we'll sit here and wait for these hornbills to come back one more time to this beautiful puddle of water. Here they come again. And then we shall leave them to continue with their morning. But grab some screenshots. Now that we know where there's a hornbill nest, we can try and follow up, of course, like we will try and do with a magpie shrike nest as well as the crested barbet nest, and like we have been, of course, doing with the Wahlberg's eagle's nest. That's a big piece. My goodness, very ambitious. Working hard. Now, birds will typically have chicks sort of once a year. Obviously, it just depends on the species. If you're a southern ground hornbill, well, that's every 7 years or so. But typically for the rest of the birds, they will start mating normally around this time of the year, usually from September, even then, of course, well into October. Some of them, the incubation periods are a little bit less, maybe even as late as the end of November. So it's typically around the rainy seasons, and it varies, so it depends where you go. If you're up in Zambia, I'm almost certain that the breeding seasons would be completely different if they are the local residents in the area. Perhaps the red-billed hornbills, which they do have, they probably will breed in at the beginning of the year, almost around February, March, when they get most of their rain. And now, obviously, when we have a lot of rain, it's a rejuvenation of the land. Of course, it fills up all the watering holes. And most importantly is that an abundance of insects comes about. And that's a very important food source that they need. In the winter months, we don't see as many insects. And I think that's why these birds generally breed in the rainy seasons. Are they coming back? They're hopping around in the distance. I'm just having a look, spotting them. They're just sitting down behind some of these trees, but we'll wait patiently because I'm sure we'll get them once more coming towards us. And I think it would be beautiful if you've missed the opportunity to get a reflection shot. Well, you better be prepared this time, and hopefully we'll get one more chance to do that because that is very special. There it is. I'm going back to the nest. Oh no, just hopping onto the next tree, slowly making its way back around. But this is what's so exciting is finding these little things. I'm actually going to make a marker on my map so that I remember exactly where this nest is. Let me do that. Now, Peggy, you've brought some great information to my attention that I sort of overlooked with a question we had earlier about if the male dies with a hornbill species. Now, Peggy, you've said that, of course, as we know, she pulls all her feathers out to line the nest, of course. Now, it's a good question. I don't think she would actually be able to leave. Maybe she'd have to try and grow her feathers again. I don't know what that would look like. Imagine all of a sudden seeing a bald red-billed hornbill, whichever species of hornbill it is, hopping around on the ground. But that would be quite difficult. So perhaps the male's role is really so important that if he dies, maybe the female dies with him too. Again, I've sometimes seen it though, where the hornbills will just bring lots and lots of food back all the time, and they do have quite a bit of a fat reserve on their bodies. Remember, she's not doing too much flying around, so she's not using a lot of energy and sort of resources, so perhaps she could survive. I mean, I don't think the incubation period is too long. Let me just double check in the book. Actually, I think I'm going to have to look on my app, on my mobile very quickly. I just want to double check, just have a look and see what the incubation period is. Where's a red-billed hornbill? Let's go over here. I'll show you my little app. Let's go in here. Let's go breeding. No, we need breeding. We need to go all the way down here to all this amazing information. Population, no. Habit, no, we don't want that. Foraging and food, no. Breeding, here we go. Nest. Now, laying dates. There we go. That's what we're looking for. And incubation. This is an amazing app that I'm able to find out all this information on. Just having a look. Oh, let's have another look at the bird. He's come down for another drink. Remember to keep snapping photos. So the incubation period is about 25 days. So that's not particularly too long. I think these animals are so resilient that perhaps the male would have been feeding the female quite a bit of a variety of different insects. And I think she fattens up quite a bit while she's in there, not using any energy. So I think she could survive. It's obviously, it's a hard one to try and give a definite answer, unfortunately. So we just can sort of guess and we can throw these ideas around. What do you think? What do you think would happen? Do you think she could survive without, if the male died? Do you think she would leave the nest? What do you think would happen? I mean, this is a really mind-boggling question. This is what I love, is maybe I'll be able and fortunate enough to see something like that one day. Right. Let's go across to Byron, though, who wants to update you on a couple of things.
So we are trying to follow up on some wolf. Almost got taken out by a dung beetle. So we're trying to follow up on wild dogs. We've just had an update that they think the wild dogs have crossed onto Vuyatela, onto Juma. So trying to get there get into that area very quickly, and maybe we're lucky and we see some wild dog this morning. Problem is they do cover large distances very, very quickly. So I'm trying to get there as quickly as possible, and hopefully we get a sign of these animals. It's very exciting. I haven't seen wild dog here before, so it'll be a first for me to see wild dog in this area. And around this time of the morning, they're possibly still hunting. That's also why they do cover huge distances. They'll just run and try and not necessarily ambush, but just run down prey. So we're gonna just keep scanning very carefully. I'm trying to get into this area where we think they crossed onto our boundary, or crossed the boundary onto our property. We'll see. These persistence hunters, the wild dogs are known as persistence hunters. They'll run constantly run down prey. So what they do is they'll run very, very quickly, very fast. They'll work as a pack, they'll work together. I think we'll carry on going. I'm just trying to think. You see, it's hard to say exactly where they crossed. Let's have a look. There's some plains across to our right, and there's a little road here. So let's cross onto the side. So as I was saying, these persistence hunters, they'll just run and run and run until they eventually do catch something or flush antelope out a thicket, and then they'll run and work together as a pack to catch their prey, whatever it may be. Generally, they do prefer antelope the size of impala, but I have seen wild dog hunt animals much larger than that. This is very exciting. To stick along this way. Trying to see if I can see any tracks, perhaps there's wild dogs running across. There are some elephant off to my right. I'm not going to stop for them. I'm going to try and see if we can't find this wild dog first. Because if you do end up stopping, the next thing you know, they'll be gone, completely off the property. So I'm going to carry on searching while I do that. Let's get an update from Taylor.
So have any of you had any thought as to what you think would happen with the southern red hornbills? I like trying to create these discussions. It's always good to get so many different people's ideas. And then often something you may not think of, something like, for instance, you know, at the back of my head, of course, I know that the hornbill, the female hornbill, will shed all her feathers when she's in the nest, but I didn't even think that how that would affect her fly. And just because someone else brought it to my attention, thank you, Peggy. I mean, it's great. So I'd love to hear some of your ideas. So remember, please keep feeding them. Rebecca will let me know when a few of you have said some interesting things. But I'm just trying to look. Here we go. And we might have another glimpse again. Coming back in. Oh, why was that in the water? I don't think that was supposed to happen. That was quite funny. I think it got a bit of a fright when it realized that it had landed. That was amazing. Come back again, maybe slightly embarrassed now. Let's see if they're going to come back. Now, Thomas, you want to know, once the chick has hatched, how long will it take for them to open the hole? I want to have a very quick look. So we had a look. This is quite interesting now. We had a look, and the incubation period is between 25 days to 29 days or so. Let's see how long it takes for that chick to fledge, because that will then obviously be and give us an idea as to how long they'll take to open the hole. So let me just have a look here. It's development and care of the young. Just want to double check, and I always like to make sure that I get sort of those days. They vary from every single bird, and it's almost impossible to try and remember them. So we just keep reading and reminding ourselves. Right, so it seems as though it's about 30 days, so a month, that development of the chick will develop. See if we can see those ones moving around. So it's actually quite a long time before they do fledge. So I reckon once they start to get their feathers, so sort of their first few feathers, maybe after about 10 or 15 days or so, once they've hatched, I think that they will open up that hole, that mud hole, and then the female will perhaps start developing feathers at that stage too, and then once she's got all her feathers, I'm sure she will leave and then help with the feeding process. Now, I can't see them at the moment. We're just having a little scan. They've been hopping all around there, though. It's gone very quiet. I can't even hear them chattering a little bit more. Where have you gone? Oh, I think that that's the end of our hornbills. Perhaps they're taking a break. This is sort of the longest interval now that we've had since they haven't come back. Oh, hang on, before I go, let's hear what Laura has to say. Very interesting. Laura, that was a fantastic comment that you made. Laura thinks that she doesn't know if she'd be able to leave the nest because she'd need that energy to sort of regenerate new feathers, of course. And then if she didn't have any feathers to go out and try and get food, how would she get back in and all these various things? So I think these types of conversations are indeed very important to just try and hear what different people like to say. And that was one of my favorite things as guides. What we would do is when we had some spare time, we would go out and we'd knowledge share and we'd have these wonderful discussions and different opinions and then take it from there and go. But keep chatting amongst yourself. I think a debate is always very important, of course, and just to hear out what everybody else says. Obviously, we don't know for sure. I've never read that anything like this has been documented before. So we can only just speculate as to what would perhaps happen. Maybe the female and the chicks, unfortunately, would die if the male died at too early of a point. See, I can't find anywhere where it says at what age or at what stage of the chick's development does the female start developing the feathers again. Now the requests are coming in for bird nests, and I must admit I've just been lucky to have stumbled across all of them. The crested barbet nest, the magpie shrike nest, which VM helped me find, of course, and now of course this red-billed hornbill's nest that we've come across. And I know that Dave was saying that he wants to find a roller nest. Well, we will try. I've never seen a roller's nest before. So we'll keep an eye out. Like I said, this seems to be what the animals are doing at the moment, and particularly the birds is prepping for the laying of the eggs. Some of them have already laid eggs. That's quite amazing to see. So when we see some birds sort of coming to and from the same area, then most likely that means that there's a nest inside there of some sort. I thought it was a fantastic show yesterday when Byron managed to find that white-bellied sunbird nest. I need to find out where that is so we can keep checking that. But that is spectacular. I've only ever seen that once before, and I didn't ever think I'd see it again. But now there's a second opportunity for that. And it's nice to know where all the nests are. Okay, well, let's go down here and carry on for our search of the Nkuhumas. We'll leave the lovely red-billed hornbills to do their thing. And like I said, over the next couple of days, next month or so, we're going to be checking up every so often on all these different bird species. Just jumped down here. I can hear the radio is very busy to have a little listen.
Really. So we're still looking for these wild dogs. No sign just yet, but I do think we're in the right area. Well, from the update that we got, somebody had seen them crossing, so just scanning very, very carefully. Sorry. Joys of flying bugs, flying into our while you're looking for animals. See how hard it is being a game ranger. Think I'll be all right. Too soon to panic. All right, let's have a look around here. Carry on. So difficult because the wild dogs, they don't really stick in one direction. They can often change directions a lot. M. Rouse has asked a question. There's an elephant off to the right. Just have a quick look. Enjoying the roots, but let's carry on our search. Lovely to see a little an elephant around. See some impala in the distance. They seem quite relaxed. If the wild dog were here, I don't think they'd be as relaxed. So M. Rouse, you asked, do wild dogs attack people? I've never heard of an incident of wild dog attacking people. But again, we need to remember they're wild animals, and I think if you threaten them, they'll most likely defend themselves. But I've never heard of an actual attack from wild dog on people. Ah, some wildebeest over here. Off to the left. There you go. Also seem quite relaxed. Okay, we're on these clearings again, and I think there's wild dog headed around in this direction, but I can't see any sign of them at all. It's very tough. We're the only vehicle in this area, so that makes it even harder. If there were one or two other people around, more eyes, and we could cover a larger distance, we'd probably have more chance of finding them. Let's just see. Back towards this main road again. See, occasionally what the wild dogs will do is they'll run into an area and search through a bit of a thicker area, maybe across through some plains, and then come back onto a road again and run along a road. They often do that. Thank you. very exciting, but I mean, I do think that the wild dog are probably the most exciting predator to follow, just because when they do move, they move so quickly and with such intent. And they try and hunt usually twice a day, in the morning and in the afternoon. Trying to see if there are any tracks around there. So when you are following them, chances of seeing them hunting are very, very good. Got to drive quickly to keep up with them too, because they are so fast. I think Taylor's got some signal again, so see what she's up to. I'm going to continue looking for these tracks.
We've just been seeing an incredible amount of dung beetles flying around. It seems to be like large copper dung beetles buzzing about, which is fantastic because we haven't really been seeing too many dung beetles. Just the odd one that I'd find for James at the tent and some fresh dung. Well, that's exciting. So we'll see if we can actually find any fresh animal dung, and perhaps with this nice warm weather and after the rain, we may be able to watch a couple of dung beetles this morning. And I know that a few of you will be quite excited by that. I know I am excited to see the dung beetles prepping their balls. Well, let's have a look. We're going to have to look on the ground then, of course. Keep trying to see which direction they are buzzing in, but it seems as though a lot of the beetles... Oh, it's very bumpy now. I apologize for all the erosion that has occurred after the rain. And it seems as though the dung beetles are also just surveying, looking for some fresh dung. But let's have a quick look. We're going towards Gowrie Dam now, to the dam cam, to have a little scratch around here, checking in all these drainage lines that we're passing through. Oh, wow. Now, have a look here. Now you can see exactly what went on last night. Let me go back a bit. You can see all of that erosion as the water has just gushed down into this drainage line and lifted all sorts of different rocks up. So, better make sure that we don't slip inside and create an unnecessary road here. A little bit soft, not too bad actually. I thought it was going to be a lot worse, but we'll just take it easy so we don't slip inside and spin the wheels and make it worse off than what it already is. And now that's something that we're going to see happening hopefully over the next few weeks, is a lot of sort of repairing of the road. And that's something, and it's quite a big job that has to be done on a regular basis, is the maintenance, of course, of these roads, the big tractors and the graders, to try and look after them. Checking up in the tops of the trees if there's any birds. Let's go around here. Perhaps while we're here, we'll quickly see how the crested barbet is doing and if they're still in their nest. We'll just head up, and I think let's start with that. Let's go in there and have a look. They're not far now. If it doesn't look like I'm paying too much attention, I'm putting my eyes on scan and just searching through all of these little drainage lines here, these islands, hoping that the kahumas are going to pop back up again. We know that they like it here, sort of just east of the dam and that big drainage system. Well, it doesn't seem like they came out on central last night. Let's have a look at our little nest. Can you see the nest in the corner over there? Go straight in. To the left, that hole, there it is. That is the crested barbet nest. Let's see if anybody's home. We'll just sit patiently for a little bit. But perhaps they are out looking for some food. Sarah from Germany. My goodness, you see, this is what I absolutely love about bringing up these debates and these discussions, is you've come up with a fantastic theory about the red-billed hornbills and what would happen if the male were to die and were unable to feed the female while she was in her mud nest. Now, Sarah, you said that perhaps the female may cannibalize the chicks and feed on them. As you said, they're a valuable source of protein, and that could, of course, happen. Now, I'm not 100% sure, and I know that it does sound very cruel, but it is nature, and they will go through sort of extreme lengths in order to try and survive. Remember that those birds do know that they are going to be able to have another set of eggs shortly after. Maybe if it's not that year, it will be the following year again. Let's hope that that's true. I'm just listening. You can hear some rollers. Seems as though there's a purple roller and a lilac-breasted roller in the far distance having an argument. And it doesn't look like our crested barbets are home, unfortunately. That's all right. I suppose you've got to be allowed to go out at some point. Now, I think my next bet here is to go along Mvubu Road. Well, no. We've got a Wahlberg's eagle up top. That's quite nice. Now, it looks like one of the Wahlberg's eagles that we see. We're not too far from the Wahlberg's nest. They're probably out on the prowl looking for a lizard or a rat or something delicious to eat. Now, sorry, Sandy from I think it was from Canada, you had one last theory about the red-billed hornbills and all sort of birds that are similar, and you've said that often in cases where the male has to sort of feed the female and she relies on being fed by him, entire nests will perish if he were to disappear. However, you mentioned about sort of cooperative breeders, so birds that breed together and live in groups, for instance, like some of the bee eaters, sometimes you see it with the buffalo weaver and the variety of different birds. And of course, the hornbills is that, or the southern ground hornbill, is that then the rest of the group will then collect food for that female. And obviously, that's one of the benefits of living in a big group, safety in numbers. And then, of course, if something happens to one, well, then there are lots of others to help assist with the work. So that's a really good way to look at it as well. And thank you for being a part of the discussion this morning. I found it thoroughly fascinating, and I learned lots. And it's definitely given me a few different ideas to sort of work on. So thank you so much for that. Wahlbergs, you're not doing anything today. Just perched up on a tree, having a look. Well, this will be a good day because I think we're going to see a lot of movement of the various animals that have had their burrows and holes perhaps flooded by the downpour that we had last night. And of course, it's a nice warm day. And we can definitely expect over the next few days the new green grass to regenerate, which will be quite exciting. You can hear the turtle dove now calling in the distance. Just a gentle breeze. You can see that one feather on the back of the wings of the Wahlberg's eagle. Looks like it's probably due to come out now. It's just fluttering in that gentle breeze. I think you need to pay attention and do a little bit more grooming. That's lovely. But I think let's carry on. Let's continue down Mvubu Road. And let's see if these kahumas aren't somewhere around here. Now, I wonder when we're going to see a leopard again. I really am missing the spotted cats as much as I love them kahumas, and I could quite happily see them every day, all day long. I would like to see something with spots. Oh, there's a dung beetle flying around. Now, it's going to be very difficult to get it. Where's it gone? Is it going to come back? Ah, it's gone. They are so quick. They're like fighter pilots today, zooming around. It seems to just be the large copper dung beetles. Oh, a hippopotamus. Let me go back for you, Darby. Let me just say, is that a good gap? Let's have a look from the distance. Now we've got a very happy hippopotamus. Oh, you need to go a little bit forward. Sorry, let me go forward quickly. Oh, Look. Ah, Wahlberg's eagle just swooped down right over the top of my head and landed on this fallen log. Perhaps it did see something like a lizard or a scorpion or snake, anything really, and it swooped right down to try and catch whatever it did or whatever it saw. Sorry, that was amazing. I got such a fright. I just heard something coming down from above me, and I didn't even think that it would have been this Wahlberg's eagle. Wow, that was close. That was beautiful. Now, that's exactly what these birds do, is that they sit up on the trees once they think they have spotted something, and then they wait patiently and then have a look. Now, let's just jump to the other side. Let's see if we can go forward a little bit. Hopefully it doesn't get too much of a fright, but keep your eyes on that log. I'll try and go as slowly as I can. Just sneak around the corner. There it is. Pop back up again. Perhaps didn't find what it was looking for on the other side of that log. I'm going to take one or two pictures here because that is just beautiful. Not often that we get to see them down on the ground looking for their food. Isn't that beautiful? We're having so much luck with the birds today. Like I said, as nice as it is to see the Nkuhumas, this is spectacular. Look at that. Lovely light catching the bird's eye too. I hope you're snapping away. Going in deeper for further investigation. Now there's a birchel starling that's landed above it, which may cause some distraction. We'll see if it's going to mob the Wahlberg so you can see it. And back up onto the log, trying again, very persistent. I mean, this Wahlberg's eagle could have been sitting up on that dead tree for quite a long time, maybe an hour, maybe 30 minutes or so, waiting for that perfect moment. There's definitely something in there. What it is, well, we're just going to have to wait and see and hope that this Wahlberg's eagle catches it. Back up again. Very interested. That is amazing. These are probably some of the best photos I've ever got of a Wahlberg's eagle. Bill from Dalesburg, welcome and thank you for watching the show. Now you're wondering if we ever see snake eagles, and you're wondering if we do, would they tackle a mamba? Now we do, occasionally we see the brown snake eagle, which is quite beautiful and very obvious by their massive and large heads. And they would definitely take on a snake. They are specialists at catching snakes. Now a mamba, as venomous as it would be, it would definitely not miss out on the opportunity to eat a snake like that, but really anything. They're not just limited to eating snakes. They'll eat in a variety of different things, from even mammals, little mammals like a squirrel or something. I've seen them eating mice and rats before, but of course they are specialists like these birds do. They all have a speciality. And of course for the Wahlberg's eagle, it seems to be lizards and the smaller things. And of course we watch the Gymnogene, the African harrier hawks, with those very bendy legs, and they're able to stick them right down into the bark of trees and pull up things that may be living under the bark. But isn't this beautiful? Really not giving up this bird. That is so lovely. I really hope you're all taking shots, because this is probably and easily one of the best sightings I've ever had of a Wahlberg's eagle. I can't take my attention off of it. Especially this light, it's not too harsh just yet. Look at the way it walks. Rebecca says that this is quite mesmerizing. I agree, Rebecca, this is amazing. This is lovely. And it's quite nice to see them up close as well, because often when they're perched up in the tree, you don't realize how small these eagles actually are. And off it goes into the distance and probably going to try again elsewhere. But not a particularly big bird. But what a stunning sighting that Warburg's eagle gave us. Anna Marie, I have to agree with you. Anna Marie says that she'd love to have the eyesight of a raptor, even if it would just be for a few minutes. I agree. I wish I could actually just be a bird for a little bit, and perhaps a big eagle, or maybe even something like a vulture that's able to reach great heights and be able to soar across the open sky looking for all sorts of beautiful things. It is warming up quickly. Just a moment ago, David and I said, oh, it's not too hot. And we were planning about when we're going to go for a run. And now it seems as though it's turning out to be an absolute scorcher. Here comes the dung beetle. Can you see the dung beetle that's buzzing around in front of us? We're going to see if we can try and get it. This is going to be quite difficult. It's about just behind the tree. It's settling down. There it is on that, I think it's buffalo dung there. To the left. It was buzzing around on, oh no, it looks like zebra. There it is. Can you see it? Look at the dung beetles. They're there. I think I need to try and go a little bit closer. What do you think, David? Okay, let's go. Now we know where they are. They're not going to fly anywhere. Let's be a little bit naughty. Just whistle. Head around. I'm so excited. And the ground is drying up so quickly. It looks like it is zebra dung. Now that I can see a bit closer. And there we have some large copper dung beetles doing their thing. Now that's not the freshest dung. They would prefer it to be nice and moist. It's really just a little bit wet because of the rain. You can see that something's already been in there churning it up. Perhaps the guinea fowl have already got to it earlier today, or maybe earlier yesterday. Now typically the dung beetles will fly and land on dung. Normally it's a good indication. I've heard a couple of guides say that about in about 20 minutes after an animal has defecated, you'll see the dung beetles all in and around and in their dung while it's nice and wet. And the reason for that is that it's obviously easier and easy to sort of move around and mold. And you get all sorts of different species of dung beetle. There's so many of them. Obviously, they're in the largest family, the Coleoptera family, which is the family of beetles. You see that one having a good little clean. It doesn't seem to be working just yet. Just cleaning its little antenna. And there's a variety of little midges and all sorts of other things inside this zebra dung. And if you're looking carefully, it almost looks as though the dung is alive. How it's all moving occasionally. What are you doing? You're cleaning yourself. There you go, moving its back legs. Perhaps the mites are being a bit of a pest. But as much as of a pest that they are very important to have mites. When the dung beetles are moving around, they secrete a liquid around their joints, and the mites will actually feed on that and get rid of that sort of secretion. And if they don't, unfortunately, the dung beetle will become sort of stuck together and unable to move. So there's a whole little ecosystem on a dung beetle in itself. Come on, get to work. We came here to watch you roll a big pile of dung. Oh, and off it goes. It took off. How was that? It opened up its wings and said, right, I'm out of here. Obviously not the right type of dung that it was looking for. Isn't that nice? The first dung beetles that I've seen doing their thing since I've been here. All right, I'm sure that Byron is missing you quite a little bit. So I think let's go back across and find out how his wild dog search is going.
I am indeed, Taylor, but unfortunately we haven't had any luck with the wild dog just yet. I'm not giving up too soon. We've really had a good look around this area where we think they are, and there are some other guys now and that are trying to help find them. but we haven't had any luck just yet. Let's see where this other vehicle goes quickly, and then we'll move on. But it just shows you how quickly they can move and where they can disappear to. It really is incredible. And I think just as quickly as they crossed onto our property, they could easily have crossed off. So the thing is, we just need to keep looking, and hopefully we get some sign of them. But it doesn't look like there's been any sign of these animals just yet. I'm going to take another quick swing. Watch out for all these dung beetles. But it's so exciting and a little bit frustrating at the same time to know that the wild dog are around here, but then just to struggle to try and find them. But you know, that's the thing. And wild animals, they move wherever they want. You can never guarantee where they're going to go. So when you do find them, it makes it so much more special. You understand, especially the wild dogs, because they are so rare and endangered. I'm trying to see if I can't see any tracks, but again, the soil is very hard at the moment. And the wild dogs, I mean, they're not very heavy animals. They're not large predators at all. You might see some scuff marks from them running across the road, but I haven't really seen anything just yet. It sounded like Taylor's had a wonderful morning with all the birding too. The birding's been amazing. We've seen so many interesting birds this morning. There's a lot of birds calling. Still, I think the highlight for me was the red-chested cuckoo. Passing another vehicle. See, everyone's very excited now because of all this wild dog activity. So people are all trying to come out and see if they can find them. It's a predator that we don't see very often, so it is very, very exciting. Morning, everyone. So nice to see so many people on safari, enjoying their safaris. Hopefully getting to see lots of wildlife while they're out here. So David, all the way from Napa, just wanted to know who maintains the roads in this area, in the Sabi Sands Game Reserve where we are. So David, it's usually up to each property, with the ownership of each property. Those properties will maintain the roads to an extent. Usually with us driving up and down on the road, the roads remain maintained. When you start getting heavy rain like this, what happens is then every now and then we may get a tractor that'll come out and just fix certain areas that are being eroded, if that is the case. But generally we try not to make too many new roads. The roads that have been established in the past, we stick to those and we use those. Of the vehicles are waiting in different areas, just trying to see if they get a glimpse of these wild dogs running through. It's starting to warm up though quite a bit now, so I'm also sure that they may go and settle down at some point, especially if they've eaten a lot this morning. Then they'll probably settle down a lot sooner. If they haven't eaten as much, they'll still try and hunt until they get something to eat. Would be great if we find these wild dogs. We You've got to scan so carefully because these wild dogs move very quickly. If they do go through an area, you'll get these little glimpses, these flashes of these dogs running. I'm surprised we haven't seen any leopard signs yet. Very, very interesting. I haven't seen a single track. I'm not sure if Taylor's had any luck with any leopard tracks. I don't think so. I haven't heard anything from her, so. So no one's had any tracks. We're approaching another dam. Just have a look in this area and see how much water is here too. I think this is Treehouse Dam, if I'm not mistaken. There's an elephant. Let's see if I can get a glimpse of that elephant for you. Just hiding behind those shrubs. Behind that tree. See there? Yeah, I think it's going to be a really, really hot day again. Okay, let's just go have a look at this water hole or this dam up ahead. Let's see. I see a little bit of water there already. Yeah, not much. So there's a bit more water, much more water than yesterday when we passed through here. You can see it's actually, what's happened is, let me show you. So up to the right, where VM is filming there at the moment, is focused on there. You can see that little pool has filled up. That was dry yesterday. And then it's basically overflowed a little bit. You can see the catchment, how it has funneled the water down into the main part of the dam. I've got a question from someone from Indiana. I couldn't copy that name properly. About the Savi Sands, if it's still in a drought. Dave that asked that. Dave, even though we had the rain, Dave was asking, is there still a drought within the Savi Sands? Technically, yes, and the drought doesn't necessarily mean no water, it means no food. So at the moment, we still need food to grow for these animals. So I would say that there is still a bit of a drought, but if it continues the way it did last night with the few thunder showers and that amount of rain that we had, I think we will get out of it very quickly, but we need a lot more because it was such a dry season and such a bad drought. So we do need a lot more. I can see little guys under there. Have a look at that. Some dwarf mongoose. Oh, there we go. Not quite the pack animals we were looking for, like a wild dog in large packs, but these dwarf mongoose are very gregarious. Always in large family groups. Rebecca was saying, looks like they're as fast as wild dogs. They are moving very quickly. Off they go. Nice to see the dwarf mongoose. We're going to carry on our search. We're not going to give up just yet. Who knows what we find. But Taylor's got a very tall animal and a stripy animal for you to look at.
We've got two beautiful zebra bottoms and a very tall animal, like Byron just described, of course, the giraffe. But there's in fact a whole herd of zebra that are going to come out, so we're going to just sit here as they sort of funnel out and then surround this giraffe. But you can see he doesn't mind the presence of the zebra too much. He's too busy tucking into breakfast. Isn't this lovely? Now hopefully they're going to play follow the leader. And seeing as one has come out of the thicket, out of the drainage line, perhaps the others will follow. This is very nice. Now, we don't seem to be having any luck with the Nkuhumas this morning, but everybody else is playing ball, which is fantastic because it's been the other way. It's been as though the Nkuhumas have kept stealing the show and the other animals have sort of been hiding away from us. So I suppose they get to have a chance every now and then. They're coming over for some cuddles, and of course zebra are quite social creatures too. They're often seen grooming each other or playing, and of course nudging heads. Here we go. I think the little one in the middle looks like it's perhaps going to rest its head on the back of one of the zebras. That's the best way to have a snooze when you're out here. Not fun. And then after we've finished up over here though, we are going to have a look. Whoops. Sorry, I've got 16,000 people trying to talk to me. Goodbye, Game Drive Radio. Off you go. And then we're also going to go and have a look at the vultures. Now, you can hear so many different things calling in the distance. Let's have a little listen. Now, that very prominent that you can hear, that sounds like it's a brew, which there are some cicadas noise and an array of crickets and probably locusts too, and of course the chitter chatter of all the smaller birds from the tawny prineers, some opalises, odd white-browed scrub robin calling in the distance, and of course the sunbirds. There's lots going on after the rain now that it's warmed up nicely. Look at that young foal trying to sneak a suckle. You actually look like you're getting a bit too big to suckle. It's quite cheeky. Isn't that a beautiful shot? Tail flies away. Isn't this beautiful? Very nice framing, David. That is stunning. I think that is such a lovely shot. And it's quite nice. I'm happy to see that we've been giving the animals quite a bit of space now, obviously barring the lions because they don't mind it too much when you're close to them. And it seems as though the zebras are very relaxed with us being at this distance. Normally, we always spot them as we're driving past them and they get a bit of a fright and run away. We're actually quite far away from them, probably about 50 or so meters. And now you can see that giraffe being completely surrounded by the zebras. Isn't that lovely? Now we're looking at this beautiful family of zebra, all going about their day. Some of them look like they're getting ready to have a little bit of a siesta. And Fiona, you were wondering if a zebra aloe suckle. Now, I've never seen it before, and they're quite similar to horses. So what I do know is that occasionally you can get a surrogate mare, but now that is normally introduced as sort of by humans. If you find a mare that's perhaps lost her foal, and then somewhere else, unfortunately, a mare has died and the foal has survived during the birthing process, which is quite common, and then normally you can match them up. And the mare who lost her foal will usually take to the new foal, but it's not always the case. Sometimes they can be rejected. So out here, I don't think it's as common to see a zebra aloe suckling. It seems as though they're only really tolerant of their own foals. And like horses, we normally see foals sticking right close to mom and not venturing too far away. But I'm not sure. I've never seen it really. I know it is possible for zebras to have twins, though. That poor mother would have a lot of work on her plate. There you go, you can hear as a grub, I'm sure you heard that, grasshopper coming past us, the stridulating. We're hearing occasionally of the back legs. Everyone seems to be happy. And often all these sounds that we hear are either territorial calls or perhaps it's even the males are searching for a mate with whichever insect it may be or bird it may be. It Don't worry, zebras. Give it a week or so and you'll have lots of new grass coming through. I'm sure they'll look forward to that. What a beautiful morning. I'm going to count the zebra quickly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. It's a nice size herd, about 12 or so zebra here. Maybe there's a few that have already dashed into the thicket. Now that looks like a stallion to me. Very big and thick neck, broad body, and of course the swagger that only a stallion can pull off. Here we go, going through to greet. And this is what the stallion will do, is he'll constantly keep strengthening the bonds between the different members in his harem. But of course he will have a favorite mare that he'll spend more time with, where he will groom her and just show a little bit more affection than what he would towards the others. That's quite funny, looking over the top. Now, depending on how long this stallion, he does look like he's the boss in this herd, would stay in this herd. I think he would just have one female. But if he were... Oh, very quickly, let's go to Byron.
In front of us. Look here, everybody, we found the wild dogs very, very briefly. They might actually end up crossing our boundary again. They're just crossing up ahead. Hang on, I'm going to try and follow them. Like I said, they cross and move so quickly. There they are, straight in front of us. Fantastic. What a nice surprise. So they've been wandering in through this really dense, thick area. And they've just come out into our view now. Oh, this is wonderful. Not sure how many there are. I can only see three at the moment. So I'm not sure if this is a large pack. I don't see any others, I just see the three. There they go. Aren't they beautiful? African painted wild dog, or African painted dog. Wild dogs, very, very rare and very endangered. Oh, it looks like they're going to be crossing our boundary very soon. And there they go. I'm so glad we got to show you these dogs just before they cross again. See how quickly they move into an area and then out again. Very, very quickly. It sounds like this pack is a pack that has been seen fairly regularly, and it's known as the Sabi Sands Half-Tail Pack. Oh, they're drinking at the moment. Hang on. I'm just going to try and get... There are other vehicles around here, so I'll try and get us into a position. They've got in front of us now. And then they're just crossing over our boundary. So apparently the Sabi Sands Half-Tail Pack has only got three members in it. The other dogs apparently died because of a canine disease called canine distemper. And apparently it's two males and a female in this pack. They've just crossed our boundary now, but I'm so glad we've got a brief view of them. And wasn't that fantastic? It was exciting. A bit frustrating at times trying to find them, but at least we got a view of them. And that is really, really great. Any sign of wild dog is amazing, because you don't have many of them around. To be able to see them coming through a property very quickly is incredible. So that was really, really great. So I mentioned that the rest of the pack had died from canine distemper. So it's a canine disease which is caught, and it kills them very, very quickly. I don't know much about it, because I haven't really come into contact with packs that have suffered from it in the past. I know of one pack in another area that died, and it wiped out an entire pack of about 15 wild dog. And it works very quickly. Within a week, the wild dogs die from it. But I'm not exactly sure how it affects them. I'll have to try and find out more about that for you. But... So apparently this pack was a lot larger, but some of the other dogs had been affected by the canine distemper, which killed them. But that was incredible. Yeah, they've crossed right or across our boundary south, and they've headed south. So I remember, actually, I think this pack, I know, have been seen on Londolozi too, so much further south. I remember seeing them, or reports of them being seen there around August, September. So they obviously cover huge distances, and the wild dogs do. They really cover massive, massive distances. They'll have, I've watched wild dogs before where we cover about 10 kilometers in one morning. And Leroy has asked us a question. He would like to know, where do wild dogs sleep? So Leroy, wild dogs will sleep wherever they feel comfortable. They'll find an area, usually a well-covered area that they can take shelter, you know, from the sun during the day. And then at night, they'll probably sleep in an area where it's a little bit thicker to avoid other predators. Wild dogs are mainly diurnal, which means they're active during the day. Not like lion and leopard that are nocturnal, or predominantly nocturnal, which means they're more active at night. So Leroy, they'll sleep just about anywhere, but they will look for some form of shelter. And then in winter, that's the time the wild dogs usually den. And when they are denning, they'll find an abandoned termite mound, something that perhaps maybe a warthog or an aardvark has excavated a little bit. They will then go in, excavate that a bit more, and they will use that as a den. And the alpha male and female will mate, and they will give birth to pups. And she could give birth, I think I've read, up to 10 or 14 pups in a pack. And it looks like we're in time for coffee. Some of the guests enjoying their morning coffee on their safari. Morning, everyone. Morning. Enjoy. And so as I was saying, so the wild dogs, once they den and they give birth to these pups, the alpha female looks after those pups in the den site. And the rest of the pack, when they go for hunting and when they feed, they return to the den site. Every day they'll return to the den site and they actually regurgitate food for the female and for the pups when they get old enough to eat meat. And then from about 3 months, 3 to 4 months, those pups start following the pack. And they won't necessarily help with the hunting, but they will follow the pack when the pack do hunt, and they will then move out of the den site completely and roam around their territory. What a fantastic sighting. Very quick, but that is often the case with wild dog sightings. It can be quick, and they're in and out of an area very quickly, and then they're off again on the hunt. But I do think they're going to start settling down. The fact that those wild dogs went straight to that waterhole quickly, or that little puddle, quickly had a bit of a drink, shows that they are getting quite warm now. They're probably going to go look for some shade and rest for the day. And later this afternoon, they'll most likely get active again, just as it cools down, and they'll probably try and hunt again. Thought I saw an elephant. I think it's just a large termite mound. It is indeed. Planes flying over. You know, a lot of the guests fly into these lodges around here. Most of them have got their own airstrips. Makes it very easy for the guests to arrive. So they fly in from Johannesburg direct to the lodges. So they arrive in the morning, usually from their overseas flights, and arrive at the lodge, and by that afternoon they're out on their first game drive. Let's see what else this morning holds for us. So Anne from Durban has asked, what happens to the non-alpha and male and females, or the beta and the lower down the hierarchy, the wild dogs? Do they not come into estrus at all? No, I think it is suppressed by the alpha male and female, so they don't come into estrus. I've heard in, I think, one or two instances where a beta female has mated with the alpha male and has fallen pregnant, but it's very seldom. Usually it's only the alpha female that will give birth to pups and raise the pups. The rest of the pack is purely there to then help raise those pups and look after them. And if something happens to that alpha pair, then the next in line, the beta male or female, they will then take that role as alpha male and female. So our hard work paid off this morning. We searched and searched and searched. We thought they were in an area. Luckily, one of the other vehicles managed to get a glimpse of them moving through that thicket. They let us know. And that's, again, the importance of teamwork, working together to search different areas, because the chances of finding animals then are a lot better. Winter Prism has asked us a question. She would like to know, are the wild dogs on the endangered list? Yes, they are. They are indeed on the endangered list. I'm just going to stop in the shade here for a second. They are indeed on the endangered list. Very rare, very endangered, and there's a lot of research going into protecting wildlife, the wild dogs. Winter Prism would like to know, but are there efforts in vaccinating them against these diseases? To be honest, I don't really know how much research is going into vaccination of these diseases. I think sometimes it's actually unavoidable. They can't do anything. But there is constantly research There's research being done on the wild dogs constantly, and they are trying to protect them, and the conservation going into wild dogs is very, very active at the moment. And there's a lot of what they do too is they'll try and take packs from one area and move them into other areas. The reason for that is to prevent too much inbreeding, so to hopefully increase the gene pool. That is also one of the killers of wild dog, is interbreeding or inbreeding rather. So that does affect them. So there are actually a lot of issues with wild dog, and that's why they're so endangered. The main issue, I think, is because of man's increase in encroaching on natural habitat. The natural habitat that wild dog would use has decreased, and that has dwindled the numbers substantially. That's probably the main reason, but also the diseases and other predators. You know, they're not very high on the predator hierarchy, and not that they get hunted, but if they come across any predators, especially lions, the lions will kill them purely because it's competition. So, and they are not nearly powerful enough to defend themselves against lions. Oh, and speaking of endangered species, Taylor's got a very interesting one for you to see.
Remember I told you this morning that I could hear the southern ground hornbills calling quite close to that buffalo carcass? Well, here they are, and I wonder if they are perhaps not going to come across and try and feed on this buffalo. So what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go forward, because I don't want to block their view. We know how shy the southern ground hornbills can be. So let's go forward and see if we can get a view of the vultures on the carcass, and then perhaps they will come towards us. So I'm going to pretend and move away from them, and then we will just sit quietly. I can see a female, or maybe even a juvenile. They're all around us here, so I'm going to just find a nice spot where we've got a view of the carcass, and then we're going to sit still, because if we don't, those birds are probably going to move away from us. So now we're going to sit here and not reposition again. I know it's quite difficult. We can't really see the hornbills now, but let's be a little bit patient. Obviously, it would be really amazing if we could get them going onto the carcass. I think the vultures are full, and that's perhaps why they're not right here eating at the moment. And maybe we disturb them just a little bit coming in. Of course, the hooded vulture not going anywhere. You can see that vulture feces now on the back of the buffalo from where they've been jumping around on top of it. And in it goes. Hornbills, come back. I think that's exactly what's happening, is they've picked up on the scent of this buffalo. Now, James Richard, you've pointed out a fantastic sort of thing that the vultures sometimes do, and I believe you said they do that in the States, where they'll defecate on their legs to try and keep themselves cool, and sometimes I believe that it can act as an antiseptic as well. Now, we don't really see the vultures doing it, but a bird that we were chatting about, chasing the hooded away, is the marabou storks do it particularly well, where they do defecate on their legs, and that's often why you see them with white legs. In fact, their legs aren't actually white, they're grey and black in colour, like we see with the vultures. So that is a bird that does it very, very well, the marabou storks. Still having a feed. You can see now the flies are really gathering all over this carcass. And the dung beetles are around. Everybody's out today after this rain. I think it was obviously just enough rain to soften the soil nicely. And perhaps, is this going to be the rain where we're going to see the explosion of termites? I'm not sure, but I'm hoping it will be. I love that scene with the hooded vulture standing on top. And of course, the whiteback eating away, not too bothered anymore. Now, even though it's just the two of these vultures here, the others are perched up in the trees and around the area, and I'm sure when they feel a little bit hungry, they'll come back down again. Now, Sarah, you're wondering how much of this carcass will the vultures eat. They're pretty much going to eat everything except for the bones and, of course, the skin. They can't eat the skin, so the hyenas are usually good at taking care of that. But everything else, oh my goodness, they're right above us. It's going to be, I don't know if you're going to be able to get this. They are all over us. They've now seen the carcass, so they're all coming into land. And this is also quite nice to see. Even though they are circling, notice how they are descending as they're circling. So this is something to look out for. Oh my goodness, they're everywhere above us, all coming down. So this is going to be fantastic. They'll just sit in the same spot. Remember, often you can get confused when you see vultures circling in the sky. You can mistake them if they're catching thermals. But remember, if they're going downwards and not sort of getting higher, then you know that there's possibly something dead on the ground, and that's what they're going after. But let's see, they're slowly coming down. It's beautiful. My goodness, please don't poop on us. We should have brought an umbrella, David, as protection. Oh my goodness, look at all of them. Now, we've seen quite a few vultures that are perched up. My goodness. That one almost hit us on the head. It was so close it came in. Now, sorry, Sylvia. Sylvia, I want to know if the vultures ever get to the point where they've eaten so much that they can't fly anymore. And I think if they desperately need to, they'll be able to fly. But normally what we see is after they have fed and their crops are nice and full, they'll perch themselves up on a tree and then do a little bit of grooming. That's a beautiful shot. I may even take a little picture. They're posing so nicely. Ah, that's lovely. What a beautiful day it's been. The birds have been on form this morning. It has been a wonderful birding day. Probably, I'm actually quite confident in saying that this could be the best birding day I've had in a very, very long time. It's quite difficult to top the day when I saw 6 Narina Trogons in one game drive, and I know that Byron showed you a photo of the beautiful Narina Trogon. But this has been pretty spectacular, getting up close and personal with all the birds, seeing them building nests, seeing them groom themselves, seeing them feed. We've seen so much different activities. Oh my goodness, Byron, you are having such luck today with all the reptiles, and let's go and see what Byron has got for us now.
Right, so we found the other tortoise species that I was speaking about earlier this morning, a leopard tortoise, moving away from us now, just behind this tree. Hang on a second, it might come out on the other side. Let's just wait and you'll see the shape of this shell or carapace compared to the other one. You can see it nice and round, much larger than the Speke's hingeback tortoise. I wonder if it's going to settle down there. I don't want to disturb him too much. They can get much, much larger than this. It's the largest tortoise that we find in this area. And but beautiful patterns on it, on that shell, or that carapace, the leopard tortoise. I think what happened was we saw it just as it was drinking, this little puddle in the middle of the road. So as we were talking about earlier, all this water around now, these little creatures start coming out. So this is really fantastic. It's the second tortoise we've seen today. It's just hiding in there now, probably looking for some shade. I'm not going to disturb it. At least it got some water, so that's good. They, you know, they need a lot of water. And this time of year now, with all this rain, is fantastic. I'm so glad we got to see a leopard tortoise. Not quite the leopard we were looking for, but a leopard tortoise nonetheless. All right, let's see what else we can find. Taylor's got some aggressive birds apparently that she'd like to show you.
Finally, we've got the feeding frenzy we've been waiting for. I'm not going to do too much talking here because I want you all to crank that volume up again and just have a little listen. Isn't this incredible? Some serious arguments going on now. Oh wow, look at them really having a go at each other. And this is it, fighting to be the number one, to get the best bits. This carcass is going to disappear very quickly. I hope you're taking lots of screenshots. Oh, look at them having a fight over a piece. Squabbling. It's like they forget that there's a big carcass right in front of them and there's more than enough to go around. I think that the little gap is obviously so small. They're all having to put their heads in the same spot. Darby, would you like me to go forward a little bit more? Are you sure? Like, that maybe not a little bit better? That's, I think, a bit much better. Here we go. Sorry, I just rolled forward. Stealth mode. Come on, hyenas. Hear all this commotion and come and join us. I hope that you are all enjoying this as much as I am. The last time I saw vultures on a carcass like this was when a hippo had unfortunately died. And that was many months ago. Did you? If you had your volume up, you would have heard the African fish eagles calling as well. And that's a bird that surprised me. I didn't think that they would scavenge very much. And the one day I did, in fact, come across an impala that had died next to a river down in the Eastern Cape, and I saw two African fish eagles quite happily scavenging on it. So that's another bird that will make use of any opportunity. But isn't this absolutely amazing? I almost don't know what to say. It's so special. And I love how they open up their wings to try and intimidate the others, to make themselves look bigger. Now we're really only just seeing the hooded vulture on here now. The white-backed vultures, and of course the hooded vultures have been around and keep coming in occasionally. But unfortunately, they're being bullied by these larger whitebacks. Now, Fuzzman Sparkles, you're wondering, what are the chances of a leopard-faced coming here? Quite large, actually, with all the vulture activity that's been going around. But perhaps we may see one. Oh, we'll sit here patiently and see how this all unfolds. But they're not as common around here. And when we do see the leopard-faced vultures, we seem to just see one or two of them come through. And then, of course, the white-back vultures have to take a step down because those leopard-faced vultures are massive. Wow. So it sounds like Herbert is sitting in final control watching the show. Hello, Herbert. Herbert had a funny comment that Rebecca passed through to me. Herbert said that they run like tootsies. Now, tootsie probably sounds like a strange word, but it's what you'd give to a criminal, basically, but sort of perhaps somebody that's not very well dressed. Look at them having a go at each other, but sort of very grim and grimy looking, and maybe walks with a dragging its leg. And they are quite funny. Not the tsotsis, but of course the vultures are quite hysterical. There are hundreds of vultures in the sky circling. It's quite difficult to try and catch them exactly though, because they're all spread out, but they are coming in. Oh, I keep not wanting to talk because the flies keep going in my mouth. I just had one go into my eye. I don't know what to do. And I know where those flies have been sitting. Now, Kathy, you're asking a great question. Kathy, you want to know, what role do the flies play in the bush? Now, they're very important, especially the larval stage is probably the most important part, is that firstly, they lay the eggs on the dead animals, and the larvae that hatches, the maggots, then devour the carcasses. So they're very good decomposers. And then, of course, the flies themselves are food for many different animals. Can we have a look at that vulture that's got its wings open? I want to show you how full its crop is. You can see their crops fill up very quickly, that big bulging thing below its neck. Now this one is full, almost just warming itself up, sunning itself up, just taking a little breather before it goes back in again. But massive wingspans. That must be almost 2 meters. Oh, there's so much commotion going on in here. Thank you, Vulture, for posing so nicely. Look at all of them. They get very angry with each other. They're not shy. Very much the biggest and the strongest will be the one that eats the most. Look at them all, kicking and shoving and pecking each other. This is a real feeding frenzy. Also trying to keep an eye out to see where those hornbills have gone, but I think they've gone away from the vehicle. We know how shy they are when it comes to us, so I don't blame them. Perhaps they're only going to come to this carcass once we've moved off. My goodness, I'm going to have to very quickly put some sunblock on while you watch these vultures. The sun is scorching at the moment. David, would you like some sunblock? David's got lovely olive skin. He doesn't need the sunblock like I need it. Oh my goodness, that was a high jump. Look, a bit of mixed martial arts going on in here. Oh, shoved off. Being pushed off the top of the car. It's almost like king of the castle here. Look at all the flies that are surrounding us, the midges. Now, oh wow, you can see they're being quite savage with each other and really having a go. And I know that Emma wants to know, would there ever be enough violence between the vultures that one would die? I've never seen it before, but it wouldn't put it past me. They can be quite savage, and especially if you get a whole lot of them sort of ganging up on one, perhaps it could succumb to some injuries. Look at them. Now, children, there's enough buffalo to go around for everyone. Be patient and wait your turn. I love how they stamp their feet. That one that we're looking at now, every now and then it raises its foot and stamps it down onto the ground. They are such beautiful animals. I'm strange, though. I like the vultures. I love the hyenas. I think the uglier they are, to me, the more amazing they are. But of course, that's just my opinion. Wow! Coming in for a second go, or a third, or a fourth go. Oh! The one that's got his head in the buffalo's bottom didn't seem to mind being landed on top of. And that's what those long necks are for. You can see there's not very many feathers on the head, and that allows them to stick their heads into these crevices and reach in and pull bits or chunks of flesh off like that. They are very funny, these birds. Sure, not letting go there. Well, there's lots of them. Isn't this amazing? Well, I think we're going to have to head across to Byron, though, who has had an incredible drive this morning, and he has got one last little surprise from you, but we will catch you a little bit later.
Another surprise indeed, Taylor. Look at these. We found the lions. Well, Herbert, our dear friend Herbert, have a look at this male. Let's just see what he does. Our dear friend Herbert was driving around and he spotted these lions not too far from camp, actually. We saw their tracks earlier this morning, so they obviously moved around while it was still cooler and now have found a little spot to probably rest during the day. Oh, look at that male. Now, what he is doing is, and let's see if he turns and faces us with that snarl. No, he's not doing it again. So, what he was doing is he was actually smelling the female, and what they do is it's known as a Flemin grimace. And the male lions have this organ at the back of their palate called the Jacobson's organ. And what they do is they taste the air they taste the urine of the females usually, and what they do is they push that scent onto their palate. A little bit of a yawn there. Onto their palate, onto that organ at the back, the Jacobson's organ, and that allows them to tell whether or not the females are in estrus or not. That's known as phlemon. There are a number of animals that do it, but it's really great to see the lions do it because they pull their face and it looks like they're snarling, or sometimes I've heard some people refer to it as smiling. But it's them trying to see whether or not the females are in estrus or not. I just saw some movement to the back, possibly I think the rest of the pride moving around there, trying to find some shade. It's getting very, very hot now. But this is great. At least we know where to look for them this afternoon. So Leroy, who is a new viewer, has asked, do we ever get scared, or do I ever get scared while watching the lions? So Leroy, no, I wouldn't say I get scared. I do have a lot of respect for them though, and I won't try and get too close because I know how powerful they can be. And but not afraid of lions. I think also in my experience in guiding and spending time following and tracking animals, you know, we need to remember animals are still more afraid of us than we are of them. And as long as you don't push the boundary too much and you don't threaten them, they'll avoid you just as much as you'd want to avoid them. So it's nice to find these lions, and they are resting. And I think we may do the same. Viam, what do you say? We've had a fantastic morning. I hope you've all enjoyed it. Thank you to Viam on camera with me this morning. Thanks to the ladies back at FC, the voices in my head, as I call them. And we will see you all this afternoon. Head back to Taylor, see what those vultures are up to, and enjoy the rest of your day.
They are still eating away, as you can see. And I'm wondering where the rest of the vultures have gone, because they circled overhead and then they've now disappeared. Perhaps they've just perched themselves on some trees in the distance. Now the frenzy is starting to die a little bit. I think that the vultures that we're looking at have started to sort of eat their absolute maximum now, and they possibly can't fit anything more into their crops. A few more are going to give it a go. And this always reminds me of what it would be like to sit around a few million years ago watching dinosaurs feed, perhaps some gregarious dinosaurs. They're carnivorous, of course, and I think this is as close as I'm ever going to get to it with all the different sounds and the behavior. Isn't this just amazing? And I've got some interesting and good news to tell you. There's a lot of these little insects that are flying around at the moment, not just the normal flies, but it seems to be, and I managed to catch one very briefly, and it looked like the alate of an ant. And I think that we just had the perfect amount of rain, and perhaps the explosion of alates for the ants is currently happening. You can actually see them occasionally around the vultures as well. You'll see them fluttering, not those big flies, but you'll see something finer with longer wings coming through. Another big argument, which is quite exciting because that gives us hope that perhaps in the next few days we're going to see the explosion of the termites, which is going to be very, very exciting. Look at them all fight each other. Oh, I'm getting very angry now. A new set of vultures circling are coming over us now. Perhaps they'll find a spot to land and then come through. Here we go. He's opening his wings. Well, I don't know if it's a he or she. I remember yesterday. Oh my goodness, look at that one getting attacked down on the bottom left. Yeah, I showed you. I reckon that's what that one had to say. Now, trying to tell the difference between male and female is almost impossible. I tried to do a bit of research yesterday, looking in all the books and comparing photos, it is very difficult. They're very, very similar in size. Ooh. This is incredible. This is what I wish anybody that comes on a safari could see. It's one of the most spectacular things in the bush, and apparently it's David's first feeding frenzy as well. Now, unfortunately, it's come to that time where I'm going to have to say my goodbyes, but they're just going to be quick ones, so I can leave you watching the vultures. But I hope you've enjoyed the show with all the birds today, and I look forward to this afternoon and see what surprises we have for us. So have a fantastic morning or night if you're heading to bed, and we'll catch up with you this afternoon.